Organization of Future African Neurosurgeons weekly webinar. Today we are going to have two presentations by two presenters, Ndali Genevieve and Wah Praise from Cameroon. But before moving to the presentation, I'd like to present the panelists who are here with us. So, hello, Arsene. Please, can you unmute yourself and present yourself, please?
Hello, everyone. Hello.
Hey, hello, we are getting you, Arsene.
Yeah, my name is Arsene Daniel. I'm from Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm a medical student in the final year of medical studies. And it is a great pleasure to be a part of this panel today. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Daniel. You're welcome. So next is Dr. Kabulo. Please, Dr. Kabulo, can you present yourself?
Hello, everyone. My name is Kabulo from Democratic Republic of Congo, training in Zimbabwe. Nice to meet you all.
It's a pleasure to have you, Dr. Kabulo. Next is Dr. Hugh. Please, Dr. Hugh, can you present yourself?
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Hugh Dokpono from Benin Republic, undergoing surgical training in Morocco. Thank you.
You're welcome, Dr. Hugh. Next on the list is Dr. Marvin. Please, Dr. Marvin, can you present yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Marvin Topmene from Cameroon. I'm actually postgraduate year one researcher in Ivory Coast.
It's a pleasure to have you, Dr. Marvin. Next is Lauren. Please, Lauren, can you unmute yourself and present yourself? Lauren? Probably should step out. Next is Emmanuel Dinga. Please, can you present yourself?
Hello to everyone. I'm Ngu Emmanuel Nzinga from Cameroon, a level 4 medical student. Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you. Next is Pablo. Pablo, please, can you present yourself?
Hi, I am Pablo, and I am a resident of neurosurgery from Chile in Latin America.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to have you. Please, how did you know about AFAN?
How do I know that this is going about this webinar?
Yes, doctor.
Because I am subscribed in a group of Facebook, and it was, you know, it was published there, and that's how I am trying to get into every webinar about neurosurgery.
All right, thank you so much. It's a pleasure to have you. Next is Patrick Robert. Please, can you present yourself? Probably it's not there. Next is Rafael. Rafael, good guy. Please present yourself. Not there too. Okay, Samuel Chilawa. Please, can you present yourself? Oh, Rafael is there. Rafael, go and present yourself. Mm-hmm. Yes, you're getting it, Rafael.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. It's okay?
Yes, we're getting you.
All right. Hello, everybody. I'm Rafael Yikaye, level 6, medical student in Cameroon. Thank you.
Great. Next is Samuel. Samuel, please present yourself.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Samuel Chilawa, medical student from Zambia.
Great. Next is Dr. Oric Sidney. Please, Dr. Oric, can you unmute yourself and present yourself? Probably step out. All right, so I am Zolo Ivan. I am a CTA medical student, and I'm the head of communication and operation at the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. As I already said, you're all welcome to this webinar presentation, and I'll give the floor directly to Wah Praise, who is going to present himself and go on with his presentation. Wah Praise, you have the floor, please. Go on.
Okay, thank you. I'm Wah Praise, a 40-year medical student from University of Buya, Cameroon. Okay. Seems as if I've been disabled from sharing my screen.
Wait, let me look into that. All right, try again, please.
Okay.
That's great.
Okay, it's okay. Okay, so it's taking time to go to the presentation. Okay, so these are the plan for how we will go through. We'll start with the introduction, go to the types, the courses, the clinical presentation, diagnosis, treatment, and then we'll conclude. Okay. So what's lordosis? Lordosis is the normal inward curvature of the lumbar and the cervical region of the human spine. So if we look at this picture here, we will look at someone with a good posture and then another one who has lumbar lordosis. So in the human, lumbar lordosis permit the human to bring the bulk of their weight to the pelvis, and so it therefore enables for a more efficient gait than that of other primates. So we move now to the types. We have lumbar hyperlordosis, which is excessive inward curvature of the lumbar spine. They are also called hollow back, sway back, or saddle back. The image here shows that we have an individual with a good posture with the lumbar lordosis, and the other one with lumbar hyperlordosis. Actually, this is a human model. So in real life, the lumbar spine is curved forward. So the human model that is being displayed by this sway back, it's just trying to imitate how the sway back will look like. So in a normal, in real life, it's more curved forward than what is shown here. Okay, so the causes of lumbar hyperlordosis, we have imbalance in muscle strength and length, such as having weak hamstrings and weak hip flexors, can cause that. Also, health conditions such as achondroplasia, spondylolisthesis, and osteoporosis can also cause lumbar hyperlordosis. Okay, the second type is lumbar hyperlordosis, which is less common than hyperlordosis, and occur due to a less curve in the lower back and flattening of the lower back also. So the causes of lumbar lordosis, we have abnormal spine formation. Okay, in individuals who have an extra vertebrae, extra lumbar vertebrae, that allows for more flexibility, so predisposing him to lordosis, to lumbar lordosis. And the second cause is what leg discrepancy. Okay, individuals who have one leg longer or shorter than the other, are predisposed to lumbar lordosis, because this will cause an imbalance in the hips, in both hips, and will lead to poor, and the individual will have to adjust himself into vulnerable positions in order to achieve aesthetic appearance. So predisposing him to lumbar lordosis. The next cause is tight hip flexors. Okay, having tight hip flexors will lead to poor hip lifting posture, that is, and also poorly hip lifting posture, that is, the individual will not be able to position himself well when lifting objects. It will lead to hip flexion contraction, that is, when flexing the hip, it will be contracting, and this can lead to serious sprains and injuries as the individual tries to adjust into a proper gait. Okay, the next is uneven muscles. Yeah, this arises from the fact that in the human, in the in the humans, each muscle has another muscle that opposes its action. Okay. In the case of in lumbar lordosis, the abdominal muscles are weaker than the muscles of the lumbar spine and the hamstring muscles. So this can also predispose to lordosis. Okay, next we'll look at the clinical presentation of a patient with lordosis. When a patient with lordosis comes to you, he has the buttocks appear to be more pronounced. He has difficulty moving in certain directions. And when such a person lies supine, there's a large gap between the lower back and the flat surface. And they also have some degree of discomfort and back pain. Okay, next we move now to the diagnosis. Okay, the X-ray is the gold standard to measure the lumbar curvature. And on the lateral X-ray, the normal range of the lordotic curvature is between 20 and 60 degrees, as it is proposed by Stagner and ANL. That is measured between 20 and 60 degrees, measured from the inferior end plate of T12 to the superior end plate of S1. Actually, some books will say it's between 40 to 60 degrees, or some 40 to 80 degrees, but the normal range varies in between these individuals. But the lumbar curvature is more pronounced in females. Yeah. So, treatment. Okay, since lumbar lordosis is caused by habitual bad posture and not by inherent defects such as scoliosis or kyphosis, exercise can help to reverse the disorder, such as stretching of the lower back, the hip flexors, the quadriceps, and the strengthening of the abdominal muscles together with the hamstring and the gluteal muscles. Yeah, so this slide shows the different exercises that can be used to adjust the defect. So the next treatment option is by the use of braces, the Boston brace. Yeah, these are special kind of braces that are made with a modified lordosis with them. These braces come with a modified form of lordosis, and they help in reducing the strain in a disc, let's say in a vertebrae that have shifted. Yeah, they will help to adjust it. So yeah, this is the second option that can be used to treat lumbar lordosis. Okay, now we'll just conclude. Okay, so lumbar lordosis is a secondary curvature of the lumbar spine. And since it is caused by habitual bad posture, it can be reversed. Okay, thank you for your keen attention. Actually, I went through some books that were sent to gather if I could have some long cases that we could go through, but I couldn't find them. I have some, multiple choice questions that we can just go through just to review.
All right.
Okay, yeah, let me go, okay. I hope everyone, okay, so, okay, I will already then we'll discuss on the answers. Okay, question one, which of the following spinal curves are referred to as primary? As primary curves. Which of the following spinal curves are referred to as primary curves? A, we have the thoracic and cervical areas. B, we have the cervical and lumbar curves. C, the cervical and sacral curves. D, the thoracic and sacral curves. So, what do you guys think? Uh,
have the thoracic and sacral.
I'm going for thoracic and sacral curve D.
Okay, yeah. The right answer is the thoracic and sacral curves. And the reason why they are considered as primary curves is because they are present from birth and they go through adult or to adulthood, unlike the cervical and the lumbar curves, which come after birth. Okay, the next question. The condition of exaggerated thoracic curvature is known as which of the following? We have A, lordosis, B, kyphosis, C, scoliosis, D, none of the above. So which one do you guys go for?
B, kyphosis.
Kyphosis.
Yeah, it's B, kyphosis. Okay, the last question. Which of the following is not true about lordosis? A, often accompanied by anterior pelvic tilt. B, can be caused by poor abdominal flexibility. C, often accompanies weight gain and pregnancy. D, all of the above. So which one do you guys go for? Yeah, take your time.
I'll go for D.
I think I go for D too. D to all of the above.
I think I'll go for D, all of the above.
Okay, they say which of the following is not true about lordosis? Yeah, the answer is D, all of the above. None of them is true. Okay, with this, it comes to the end of the lecture. If anybody has a question, he can ask.
All right. Thank you so much, Praise, for the amazing presentation. Thank you. So you move directly to the panelists for any comment or questions. We start with Dr. Kabulo. Please, Dr. Kabulo, do you have any comment or question? Of course.
Thank you so much, Praise, for your wonderful presentation. It was clear and short, so that's good. I have only one question. You said treatment, you do exercise. Is it for all lordosis? Do you do exercise?
When the lordosis exposes a limitation to the patient's daily lifestyle, I think we can go for the treatment.
Okay, I mean, is it for all lordosis, all types of lordosis, despite of whatever the cause? No, all of them. Yeah.
Yes.
Lordosis, yes, when you get them, if you do exercise, you worsen. Okay. Especially if you get a lordosis which is due to spondylolisthesis, which is like grade 5 or grade 4, grade 3, grade 4, and in an obese patient. So you don't do exercise because you worsen that lordosis.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kabulo. Darwin, if anybody has a question, please.
I'd like to add to that.
Okay, all right.
There are some lordosis that are due to osteoporosis, not only spondylolisthesis, osteoporosis. Patients there are some lordosis that just at the beginning of birth. At a young age, you can have that kind of lordosis, but the lordosis that come up with some other pathology like tumors and some mainly osteoporosis, as the presenter said, the exercise will worsen the lordosis, but the lordosis that can be worsened mainly about exercise are the ones that due to osteoporosis because the bones are not anymore in the natural. Potentiality to fit with the exercise. I think that's what he wanted to say. Okay. Thank you. That's what I wanted to add to what have been said. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
That's true. Thank you. So that's true. So Praise, what you should have done is to classify, those causes and treatment is depending to the types of lordosis.
which this one, like lordosis due to this, I will do this. Lordosis due to this, I will do this, and so on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Kabulu.
Thank you very much. If anybody has a question, you raise the hand. Yes,
yes. But there are also lordosis from patients that have been gone through treatment and had infection on the material. And then the material have been removed. And the patient came up with lordosis. Patient come with, let's say, anti-spondylolisthesis. The patient have been operated with material, and we put in material. So this material has been affected, treated, but the side of the wound is bringing out so many pus, so much of pus, sorry. The pus have been drained and patients have been treated, and the team decided to take out the material. Once the material is removed, since the patient has gone on to, has going to corporectomy with how do you call it, with putting, innovation, removing the part of the spine of the iliac bone, to graft into that part of where the corporectomy have been done with the cage, and the cage to hold on the corpus vertebrae. So this material that has been put there, the material is infected. When the material is infected, and the indication can be to remove the material. We've got this into, I think, 3 patients so far. The material is removed. Once the material is removed, you find the patient in a very, more than 60 degrees of lordosis. Well, 60 degrees of the doses. So in that case, also, as Kabulu just said, you have to put each type of the doses with the treatment. That's how it should be. Okay, anyway, thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Darwin, you have a question or a comment? Go on.
So I have both a comment and 1 or 2 questions. The first comment, I would love to probably also try to contribute to the question that Dr. Kabulu asked about whether exercises are applicable to all cases of lordosis. So from one of the situations where exercises are applicable is when the cause of lordosis is especially associated with improper posture, if I can put it so. Like if there is poor posture and then it results into lordosis, then some exercises can do. Yeah. Then I also had a question for Praise. First of all, about diagnosis, some of the investigations that can be done. He mentioned X-ray, if I'm not mistaken. But is it just X-ray, or maybe I just missed it? Is it just X-ray that can be done? What other investigations can be done, and for what purposes? So, for example, for X-ray, one of the reasons why it's done is to measure and evaluate the cave. But what other investigations can be done in the case of lordosis? Then my second question is, what are some of the management considerations? I think maybe it's also in line with the question that Dr. Kabulu asked. What are some of the management considerations that should be there in managing a patient with lordosis? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Darwin. For the investigations, to the best of my knowledge, I only know of the X-ray, measuring the lordotic curvature on X-ray, and which combined with some physical exam, history and physical exam, yeah.
Hi, guys.
Yeah, maybe Dr. Nur can help, yeah.
Hi, guys, thank you for your presentation. Praise,
which is sufficiently short and brilliant. Darwin, about when obviously, if you want to take more, you can do a dynamic dynamic X-ray to know if your lordosis is mobile or not. That is the first point you should also check in lordosis pathology. Just to know, because last time in a few minutes, Kabulo asked you if it is all lordosis you should treat. So sometimes when lordosis is mobile, it is another way you should treat that. So you need also to combine dynamic history to see if you have to fix. To go to surgery to do osteosynthesis to fix. I don't know if I answer your question, Darwin.
It's okay, Nuru. I can add something there. So praise Darwin. What Nuru is saying, it's very relevant. So you have to do dynamic X-ray. You do flexion and extension. Okay, to check if there is a stability. You do on flexion, you screen. You check the image, then you do extension, you put the patient on extension, then you check. But since he mentioned that clinically the patient can come with lower back pain, the patient can come with paresthesia or neurological deficit, it's also better to do an MRI scan because X-ray is only showing you the bones. But MRI scan will show you soft tissues. If there's neurological involvement, then you check apart from that lordosis, what else is there? What is compressing the nerves? Okay, so MRI scan is also very important at that level.